Electronically good. Call the meeting to order. I want to welcome you all today to this evening's regular council meeting. I want to open with three initial announcements. I want to welcome a group of students. About 60 students are in our gallery today. This is the Introduction to Policing program that's run by the Coquitlam RCMP Detachment. This is the 12th annual stream of this course. This is a course run by Sergeant Fareed Sudeh, Corporal Ray Stanford, and Sergeant Bruce Pitpain, the Coquitlam RCMP Detachment. It's the only program of its kind across Canada where young people are get to school students in the Tri-Cities primarily, and I understand from a little bit further than that, get to have a look at all aspects of a career in policing, and I know that some recent graduates are now RCMP officers. And so I want to welcome that group of students here to council chambers. Our first speaker tonight our first presentation is actually the RCMP officer in charge, Superintendent Claude Wilcott, on crime and safety update, and that you may find that interesting. My second announcement relates to the purple ribbons that council members have on. This is National Victims of Crime Awareness Week. This is the fifth annual such recognition of this week. Every victim of crime, no matter who they are, where they live, or the way in which they were victimized, should be treated with compassion and respect. And I know that our RCMP detachment and our City Hall join in that call for respect for the victims of crime, and that fits in well with our guests tonight. And I also want to make Council's condolences related to the tragic fire death this morning in the early hours of a resident, a female resident in Coquitlam on Burien Drive. The tragic death of this woman is recognized by council, and we extend our sympathies to her family. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Your Worship. The first item on the agenda is Superintendent Claude Wilcott from the RCMP, who will provide a crime and safety update.
I've asked the students to appear interested.
Well, they are the best and the brightest, so I guess that they are part of my posse now for the time being, so I appreciate their attendance. And just wanted to take this opportunity to let council and the mayor know where we've been and where I plan on taking the detachment.
I'm remiss. This is our first opportunity to welcome you as superintendent, and so we thank you very much. You've taken on the reins of the head of our local detachment on behalf of council. Thank you for taking that on, and we wish you very well, and we look forward to your first presentation here to council.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In 2005, I was actually approached and offered two positions, promotional opportunities. One was to Coquitlam Detachment, and one that really didn't matter. I chose Coquitlam Detachment for two reasons. One is I have close connections to the community, and I wanted to be here. Secondly was because they were a pilot program for crime reduction. Crime reduction was something I'd been talking about and been exposed to while at the Lower Mainland District, and it really piqued my interest, and I thought that I really wanted to get back to the pointy end of that stick and be part of it. So I chose Coquitlam Detachment and came here as an inspector. It's also one of the reasons that I applied for and received the job is I wanted to continue on with crime reduction. Crime reduction is a very simple philosophy. It's, 10% of our criminals do 90% of our crime. So we focus on three tenets of on crime reduction. We focus on the prolific offender, that 10%. We focus on crime hotspots, so areas that are geographically have a lot of crime occurring in them. And then we focus on root crime causation. So what's the underlying cause? Is there something we can do to, as a society, to correct these issues? So that's crime reduction in a nutshell. And I know council have heard this over and over again from the previous OIC. But one of the things that I have seen in the past 5 years is the success of the program. It's been truly successful. We need to keep continuing to build on those successes. We have a graph up there, and it's was in our trimester report, but it shows the annual decline in incidences. So that's not the crime rate, but that's the incidences of our four crime reduction types from 2005 to 2009. From December 31st, 2009, the break and enter to residences was down 22% from 2008 and 54% from 2005. Break and enter of businesses was down 1% from 2008 and 28% from 2005. Theft of motor vehicles were down 9% from 2008 and 68% from 2005. And theft from motor vehicles was down 12% from 2008 and 52% from 2005. Focus here is that we are targeting these, have been targeting these particular crime types. We undertake a lot of analysis to determine where we need to be and who we need to target, and it has been effective so far. It's been so effective that we've been getting calls from Stats Canada asking us to check our numbers because they want to make sure that there's no mistakes. We check our numbers, everything's fine, and there are no mistakes. So crime reduction has been working. Maybe a little bit difficult for everybody to see, but it's basically our property crime rate and how it's changed over the long term. The light blue areas that are to the left here are detachment-wide, so not just Coquitlam, but they're the property crime rate before crime reduction and before we undertook the project. The dark blue areas indicate the implementation of crime reduction until 2008. You can see by the black line the trend before the crime reduction was quite erratic and unpredictable. After and since crime reduction, it has been steady and sustained decline. This has not been the case in other detachments that have not gone down the road of crime reduction. The point of this slide is that our strategy is working and we're continuing to move forward with it. This slide illustrates the annual analysis cycle for our crime reduction. We start off with 2 years of prime data. Prime is our records system. So we take that data and our analyst mines it and identifies prolific offenders, priority offenders, based on their negative contacts with the police, their association with other offenders, and their history as a prolific offender. So some people will remain on the prolific offender list despite low numbers of actual contacts, but because they have a known history and they are left on there. Issues such as root crime causation and high volume non-criminal calls, those are those calls that we have a number of individuals that create a lot of work for the police, but they are not criminal calls. They are people with mental health issues, there are people with other issues. And so that takes a lot of the police's time because they do create calls for service. Those require more long-term attention, and with our creation of our community response team, one of the things that they have taken on is those long-term projects. We also assign them to our new constables as part of their rotation or their recruit field training, and we call that a CAPRA project. It's a way for them to identify the issues and to connect with the appropriate agencies to try to resolve the problem. The crime types that we select, we've been pretty consistent over the last 5 years, but our analyst reviews what most of the prolific offenders are up to. That's subsequently resulted in a bit of a change in direction this year, and we've added identity theft, which is we noticed a couple of years ago as a burgeoning issue, and so it's added as one of our tools, and we are measuring that. And these crime types we take on to what we call our CompStat, which is basically computer statistics. It's a meeting that we hold biweekly, and the analyst will take a look at what's going on and identify the hotspots for us. Once they're identified and possible prolific offenders are identified, then what we do is formulate a tactical plan and identify what team is going to take that on. So we may have identified an individual who's been breaking into buildings and have some solid intelligence on that, so we would assign our prolific target team to actually surveil that person until we apprehend them. Secondly, if we had a high crime area, then we may redeploy resources into that area to try to dissuade the criminals from committing crime in that area. This generally results in relocation, but it's not effective in the long term, so we only use that occasionally. Bi-weekly meetings involve reviewing the maps and sharing the information and the intelligence and assigning tasks and holding people or having an accountability mechanism in response to that. So once a task is assigned to a team, then in 2 weeks' time, they'll be asked for an update as to how things have gone, and we'll be able to view these statistics to determine if that strategy has been effective. So that's a crime reduction in a nutshell. It's where we continue to want to move to. It has now become a division and a district priority. It is now going to be one of the measurements that both the district and the division measure my performance as a detachment commander, and it's part and parcel of the way we're going to continue to do business. The new crime reduction types for 2010, based on the analysis, as I said, were identity theft. Our community response team is now going to be focusing and spearheading the root crime causation issues, and our third priority is more effective communication and partnership with our communities and to support crime reduction. And that's the end of my report.
Thank you very much, and I've got a couple of questions from council members. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much, Chief. You had those little skinny bars up on there, and I just missed it for a minute. Yeah, right there. A note there that it's fairly well about 5 to 6, or 5 anyway, of crimes per month or for a couple months per 1,000 people. Is that what it is?
I don't think that's based on population. It's just the crime rate itself, crime reduction post and pre implementation.
Well, it says here on the side, monthly property offenses per 1,000 population.
Okay. That's the crime reduction or the CompStat measurement that we use is based on that.
So then that would mean that probably about 620 in just a couple of months per month.
Yep. Yeah, that would be right.
And is that a common thing that happens, or is it higher than usual, or?
Well, not really, and it has gone down consistently since we started in 2005. We do get fluctuations, like currently we are in a fairly busy zone of break and enters of business right now. We've noticed that through our CompStat process, and so we've been able to, we've been targeting the business districts, the industrial areas that way. But that's just basically how we measure our successes and where we need to be.
Okay, thank you, Chief.
Okay, to further that, I guess, so that ranges then. We reached a peak at some point, October 03, of 7.2 property crimes in that month, October, per 1,000 population, and it's, and we're down the July 08, which is the previous one, the most recent one is in the range of 2.4 property crimes. So
you can actually see a bit of a pattern as well, that October in that area seems to, there seems to be a spike from the end of summer to through to October. So
okay, and Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I was pleased to see sort of next steps, speaking to effective communication. And I'm wondering, because I think that's really important, that we have to get word out that actually crime rates are coming down and that this is a good investment for us to make as a community. But yet, year after year, at least the ones that I've looked back, people's perception of crime is that it's on the increase. And I'm wondering if, you know, what RCMP's role is helping in managing that perception of crime and what the city ought to be doing and how we work together to help people sort of see that, in fact, we do live in a safe city that and crime is being reduced.
Well, and the communication on that end is very important, as well as the partnership between the city and the RCMP, I mean, the police in general. You know, there's a number of things that we've looked at that create that perception of crime, from graffiti to litter to, you know, youth in a park, which, you know, the reality is youth are in a park. But there are perceptions of crime that need to be, the public need to be educated on, and they need to hear that our community is safe. But the other pieces are that the little things that we can do to correct that, and I think that's part of the community response team's job, is to liaise with our partners in the city and other agencies and deal with those issues and try to move forward with it.
So. Great. Well, thank you. I look forward to sort of seeing how we can manage that part. I think that's actually going to be harder than the prolific offenders.
I think you're right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Councillor Lynch.
You raised a point there about youth in a park, and one of the committees that I chair, we were discussing recently about youth in a park and on what type of activities that draw are negative or positive. And one of the things that we were considering and thinking about, whether the skateboard parks, of course, we have the one in the town center, we've been very well used. In fact, one of your corporals who came to the presentation said she used to hang around the skateboard park and stuff like that. Do you have any opinions of whether, because I personally would like to see some more skateboard parks for the youth in our community, and we kind of looked at maybe thinking maybe Myardville might be a nice place to have one, and I was wondering what your perception of that would be.
I think where youth is actively engaged in some activity, I mean, you know, when you drive by those places, you can see them, they're having a ball, they're on their bikes, they're on their skateboards, they're on their rollerblades, and for them, you know, the little kids are watching the big kids. I think it's a positive environment. Sometimes you need to manage that environment a little bit, but for the most part, I think it's positive. Whereas if they're standing around under a light, not doing anything, you know, creates concern, because what are they doing? They're in a park, but at the skate park, you know, I don't see that. That's all positive.
As long as we're providing opportunities for them to be actively engaged in something that's positive.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to raise one. Graffiti. Graffiti, the broken window version of this, and to what extent do you see that as playing a role, if the tackling of the kinds of visible blights in our community, and how that plays into Councillor Robinson, for example, raised the question of perception of crime and the perception of safety. What can we do?
Well, and I think the city has already made some pretty good steps in working towards eliminating graffiti. I know that 5 years ago that was a concern. We brought it forward. We've been working with Bill Susak We've made some considerable steps in reducing that. There's some tactics that we're using as a city, as an entity, that are being successful. And I see an improvement from 5 years ago. And I think if we continue to move forward and just commit to that, it's important, because that is one of those indicators. That broken window theory is one of those things. You know, unsightly residences, that all contributes to that sense of fear in the neighborhood.
And I really shouldn't bring that up without acknowledging that yesterday, in fact, the Austin Heights Business Improvement Association and residents around there got together, and I know there were young people and entrepreneurs and such. Councillor Reamer was there as well, and we were out there painting and cleaning up. Councillor Robinson was there as well, removing graffiti, and I acknowledge those business owners who have taken charge of their neighbourhood. And
absolutely.
And I think you're right. It does not only improve the feeling of safety, but it lessens crime.
Absolutely, I agree.
Well, I thank you very much, and I want to thank all those students. I know they've got work to do as they're going to be heading out here, but I acknowledge them for coming out here tonight, and thank you.
Thank you, and thanks for backing me up, guys.
I'm going to pause for a moment because they're going to, they've got work to do. Right. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Item two is Carolyn Turpin, who is the New Westminster and District Labor Council, who is with the New Westminster and District Labor Council regarding day of mourning for workers killed and injured.
Mayor Stewart, councillors.
Thank you very much for coming.
Most of you know my name is Carolyn Turpin, and I proudly confirm that I do live in Coquitlam. I work, I learn, and sometimes play in Coquitlam. Tonight I'm here representing the New Westminster and District Labor Council, an organization representing over 60,000 unionized workers in all occupational sectors. History shows the labor movement has been instrumental in shaping the laws that govern the occupational health and safety of our workers. As part of the continuing effort to bring attention to the issue of workplace health and safety, the labor movement speaks at events across Canada on April 28th, the National Day of Mourning for workers killed and injured on the job. This year marks the 26th anniversary since the Canadian Labor Congress declared April 28th the Workers' Day of Mourning. Workers dying on the job is not a consequence of working. True, accidents in the workplace are almost rare, but incidents are plenty, and they are often caused by poorly enforced work-safe regulations, little or inadequate training, working without proper protection, working alone, and sadly, when an employer takes no responsibility for work safety. Earlier this month in West Virginia, 29 mine workers lost their lives. Having had more than 150 compliance orders filed against them, including warnings about the high levels of methane gas in the mine shafts, the company and its CEO continued to operate in unsafe conditions, putting profits ahead of workers' lives. Could such a tragedy happen in Canada or right here in BC? Absolutely. In 1992, the explosion at the Westray mine in Nova Scotia is just one reminder of how some companies flaunt the law. 26 mine workers died. The United Steelworkers were determined not to allow that company to walk away from such a crime and waged a 10-year fight for justice. They finally won an all-party support for an amendment to the criminal code under Bill C-45. The amendment was designed to impose criminal penalties on corporations that fail to protect the health and safety of their workers. Just recently, the Steelworkers Union launched a private prosecution in the New Westminster courts over the death of a sawmill worker under the Westray Mine criminal code provision. Not many years ago, on a waterfront barge in New Westminster, four men died while working in confined space, and two of their rescue workers succumbed shortly after. It was determined that not only had the employer failed to adequately train and protect those workers in accordance with WCB regulations, but had also received several prior citations for various infractions. As employers, civic government leaders know that community safety and civic worker safety requires resources, adequate staffing, training, and education. The members of our community would never be put at risk by cutting police services, but the lack of enforcement of regulations of the WCB does put lives at risk every day. The evidence for greater enforcement is clear, yet the provincial government over the past decade has supported massive changes to the services provided by WCB. It's my understanding that over one-third of the WCB regulations have been eliminated. Also, rather than protecting worker safety or ensuring adequate financial compensation to workers, it is a priority for WorkSafe to give in to employer demands for lower premiums, thus resulting in reduced services to workers, including rehabilitation services and loss of earning benefits. Our WCB system in British Columbia needs to be strengthened, not weakened. Our laws must be protected, not eroded. Remember, last year I mentioned Grant DePaty, the young man who lost his life because of $11.35 worth of gas. Because of this young man, on Friday, February 1st, 2008, WCB working alone regulation, or grants law, came into effect. This regulation included a pay before you pump requirement, as well as a requirement for retail doors to be locked between 10 p.m. and 6 a.m., or having a minimum of two workers on shift. Today, a little more than 2 years later, grants law is at risk. The regulation is under review because pressure from employers, like owners of private liquor stores, don't like the regulated staffing requirements. In closing, I admit that I don't know the number of lives lost in BC in the workplace during 2009, but I do know that last year in Canada, over 1,000 workers paid the ultimate price, and thousands more no longer have the quality of life they once enjoyed. Trade unions make workers' health and safety a priority. I believe we must all share the responsibility to ensure that human life or the quality of a human life is never sacrificed for profit or productivity. With thanks to the city manager, on April the 28th in Coquitlam, we will see the day of mourning flag at half-mast, and we will have an opportunity to remember the workers who did not come home. We will share their families' grief, and we will recommit to fight for living. On behalf of the New Westminster and District Labour Council, I thank you for this opportunity, and I extend an invitation to all of you to join with them and the BC Federation of Labour for this year's Day of Mourning ceremony at the Vancouver Art Gallery, 7 a.m., April 28th. Yes.
Thank you very much. Mr. Clark.
Item 3 is the minutes of the regular council meeting held Monday, March 15th. Recommendations to approve those minutes.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Lynch, second by Councillor Reamer. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 4 is the minutes of the public hearing held Monday, April 12th. The recommendations that these minutes be approved.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Robinson, second by Councillor Reamer. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 5 is the minutes of the regular council meeting held Monday, April 12th. The recommendations to approve those minutes.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, second by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 6 is the minutes of the Land Use and Economic Development Standing Committee meeting of Monday, March 22nd. The recommendations to receive those minutes.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Lynch, second by Councillor Robinson. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
The first item of business arising out of those minutes concerns the permanent shelter and transitional housing next steps. With Council's permission, I'll broadly summarize the recommendation. that staff be authorized to finalize preparation of a request for proposals document, that staff be continue to work closely with the Tri-Cities Homelessness Task Group and BC Housing in developing a process for evaluation of submitted proposals, that staff make application to the Regional Steering Committee on Homelessness for 2010 unexpended federal government homelessness funding. Staff be directed to report back on an approach to proceed with municipal approval processes required to develop the site at 3030 Gordon. That staff continue to urge the provincial government to sign the MOU for the permanent shelter and transitional housing at 3030 Gordon, negotiated with the province and signed by the city in March 09. And commit capital operating funding for the permanent shelter and transitional housing at 3030 Gordon Avenue. And finally, four, direct staff to initiate dialogue with the cities of Fort Coquitlam and Port Moody to explore areas of mutual cooperation and support for the permanent shelter and transitional housing.
Thank you. Second. Moved by Councillor Robinson, second by Councillor Asmundson. I will report to Council. I've let a couple of Council members know. I was in touch with the Minister, Minister Coleman, as recently as today. Related to this, Council has asked me in the past to keep regular contact, and I'm perhaps a little bit more persistent than the Minister might like, but the contact today was very positive. The Minister indicated that the project had been moved up in the priority and that he's hopeful, and I believe that we're talking imminent, hopeful that the Treasury Board will allocate some additional funds and that would put our project in line for funding. We have a lot of work to do as a city, of course, but I took that as very good news, and I thanked him for that bit of information. So, Councillor McDonnell.
Thank you. Well, this can't get going soon enough for me, but looking at the list of recommendations, I'm going to ask that we separate them because on number one and A. To finalize preparation of a request for RFPs, we've been advised by BC Housing that they would like to initiate or lead the RFP process. And I think we're getting close to getting this through. I don't want to get into any kind of a contest with them and creating expectations in our community by starting the RFP process now and then getting into an argument with them over this. I would like to ask them to come to us next month or at the earliest possible convenience.
Our next meeting's next month.
Yeah, next month. And so that we can have a face-to-face meeting with them and ask them what specifically their holdup is, because they want to lead the RFP process, so I think we could come to loggerheads over this. I completely agree with the rest of all the recommendations and support them fully, but if we can separate these, I don't think that we should be going ahead with the RFP.
We'll consider one separately, actually, on number one, on the other ones as well, the Minister, one of the questions I did ask him today was if we were to proceed, because this was on Council's agenda for tonight, if we were to proceed with rezoning and the land use side of questions, if in fact the Ministry would be comfortable with that, and he said they would be more than comfortable with us getting our ducks in a row on the land use side. We didn't have a discussion, though, about the MOU, because that is, or rather, about the request for proposals, the RFP would be with BC Housing. And I didn't get in touch, I didn't manage to connect with Shane Ramsey at BC Housing, so I would concur that it would make sense to have them out at our next meeting for one. Is your, having separated it, are you moving a deferral of one?
I would, 1A, we could do the whole first recommendation, but really 1A is the one that concerns me.
Okay. The motion is to defer 1A pending having BC Housing out, preferably at the next council meeting. Mr. Clerk.
If that is the will of council, I would, just because we have a number of speakers already identified, if that's an amendment, I will set up a QB so that people can speak to that as an amendment if it is formally seconded.
Okay. There are speakers to QB. Thank you. Seconded by Councillor Asmundson. And the speaker's to QB, please. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you.
There you go.
Got it. Okay. So I just want a clarification, because my understanding actually is that staff would finalize preparation of a request for proposal in collaboration with the Tri-Cities Homelessness Task Group and BC Housing. So my understanding actually is that BC Housing is fully apprised and involved in putting this RFP together. So if we can just get some confirmation from staff that that actually is the case. I still would like to have them come next month, but I just want to get a sense of where we're at in the relationship.
Mr. McIntyre has input, or Mr. McIntyre.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. Let me offer just a few comments, and then I'll ask our community planning manager, Rob Innes, just to comment as well. This is, we're walking kind of a fine path here. We're trying to follow up from, I think, the very successful and informative tour we took of the shelter at Langley at Council's direction. I think there was a collective interest and will to see things move forward, so we've tried to come back with some recommendations for actions to move things forward, but we want to do that carefully. We don't want to get offside with the major funding partner, which is BC Housing. So staff have been in discussion with BC Housing staff about this, so we're trying to strike that appropriate balance in terms of a recommendation moving forward, but not getting offside. So we are meeting with them this week, and so if there's direction back from council, we can certainly convey that very quickly and get things turned around. But my understanding is they're aware of this. Certainly they're aware of this. I think they're comfortable with it, but they also recognize that the city is prodding a bit. But if I could ask Rob maybe just to amplify on that, if I could.
Mr. Innes.
Just very briefly, and
if you could grab this microphone here.
Mayor and Council, just following up from what Jim was saying, is that we are meeting with BC Housing on Thursday afternoon to keep the ball rolling. But good points are well taken in terms of making sure we're working very closely with BC Housing as the primary funder in it. So we can have BC Housing come to Council and invite them to the first Council meeting in May. So again, not too much more to report, but
okay, you're comfortable with that. I'll go to Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much, Mayor. I think it's only right that if the provincial government is going to fund this, and we're giving them the land, but they're going to be paying for the building of the building and everything else, I can't see why City of Coquitlam would want to go to for the request for proposal. And then you'd be turning it over to the BC Housing. You sure wouldn't be picking the person that's going to be building it, would you?
Through the mayor. We will be working with BC Housing, and like we did with 528 Como Lake Avenue, where we again worked very closely with them. We used the BC Housing led the process in selecting the proponent for the 528, where the YWCA has been selected. We would see a similar process to that, again, where BC Housing is taking the lead with the city as an active partner, and the same with the Tri-Cities Homelessness Task Group.
Well, you've worked very, very closely with BC Housing for 528 Como Lake. It's still black soil out there, nothing else. So I wonder if anything else is going to happen on 3030 Gordon. Are we just spinning wheels here? Because 528 Como has been around for 3 years and nothing has happened.
Mr. Innes.
Your Worship, we know the YWCA has been working very actively with BC Housing to, again, it's in a similar boat as 3030 Gordon, but it is up the higher on the priority list. We're all hopeful that the YWCA project will move forward with funding very shortly.
Well, what I'm concerned about is the fact that we're now on year three for the we've gone through year three for the winter, and I think that you know what the way we're going, unless something happens, we'll be going for four and five and six. because certainly even if something happened this year, it'll take them a year and a half or so to build. So, you know, the people of this community said, were told that we're going to be rushing it up and something's going to happen a lot sooner. Well, now we're in, the 3 years are up and we're still nowhere, we're still in the same spot as we were. Matter of fact, I think you're standing in the same spot as you were 3 years ago.
Your Worship, we share that concern, and we're again working with the YWCA and BC Housing to keep that one, to get the funding for that one. So we share those concerns.
Yeah, I'd like to see it built as soon as possible. Thank you.
I'm sure we all would. In fact, on Councillor Sikora's point, when we toured other communities, for example, and examined how they got shelters built, we learned, one of the things we learned is go ahead and start this process and go through a bunch of this work to try to identify proponents. For example, Langley, who actually identified their proponent and set up the process. Is that essentially, are we modeling our proposal here after the successful proposals in other communities?
We did take, Your Worship, we did take the, you know, in terms of, we learned those lessons from the city of Langley. That was, again, there was a lesson there. There was a bit more money that was on the table back 3 or 4 years ago when the city of Langley worked with the community and BC Housing. So I think, it's working very closely in collaboration with BC Housing. We're meeting with them this Thursday to keep that ball rolling, and we will continue to be an active voice with BC Housing.
Thank you. Councillor McEnell.
Mr. Ennis, you've spoken with BC Housing since I've had any communication with them, but they've indicated that they want to be out in front of this RFP, so why would we want to do that? Wouldn't it? You're talking to them, so why you, we got this in the end?
You're right. Through the Your Worship, through the Tri-Cities Homeless Task Group, they have indicated that if the city did take the lead on its own, that they would step back. Again, we don't want that to happen. We want them to be an active and actually take the lead. As I mentioned, a similar process to the 528 Como Lake Avenue, where again we were at the table with them. We used they led the process through their RFP under the Provincial Homelessness Program. We need them to take the lead and to be okay with the operator who was and the proponent that's selected through that process. There would be too much at risk if we didn't. So hopefully that's clear.
Well, it's not very clear to me.
Okay.
Maybe I'm reading all this wrong, but your recommendation, this is your report, your recommendation is that we start the RFP process. BC Housing doesn't want us to.
BC, Your Worship, again, BC Housing is open to working in collaboration with them. And again, we'd want them to lead the process because there would be too much at risk if we didn't.
Okay. I'm just going to ask this month's acting mayor to take the chair to chair the meeting for a couple of minutes, if I could. From where you're sitting is fine.
With your new information.
Okay.
Okay. No, it's just I was under a different understanding. Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, Councillor McDonnell, then, are you okay with it as?
Well, just
no,
I want BC Housing to come and speak to us next.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Councillor Asmussen.
Thank you very much. Just to clarify, Rob, we're working in collaboration on this with the Tri-City Homeless Task Force and BC Housing on a request for proposals. But this, what I read, is this isn't going to go out or be sent out until the problems in BC Housing comes up with the funding. Is that correct?
Your Worship, that's correct. So again, we would be working with, again, at the lead of BC Housing when that funding is available. But backing up from that, we need to again, we're meeting with them this week to continue that discussion so we don't lose a beat when that funding does come available.
So we're not putting out a request for proposals ourselves ahead of BC Housing?
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Councillor McDonnell.
Now, it's the service provider that they want to identify, I understood. That's not the case? They're happy with us looking for the service provider?
No, Your Worship, BC Housing wants to take the lead, and again, with the city at the table, to select the proponent through the BC Housing RFP process. They're willing to look at the draft RFP that's been developed within the community and use that as a basis for moving forward. So again, the BC Housing, as you said, BC Housing has made it very clear that they wouldn't feel comfortable, or they wouldn't support a proponent that was selected by the city on its own.
Okay.
So we need to make sure that they do take the lead and we're at the table with them.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Clerk, where are we?
Sure. The 1A has been separated from the other recommendations, and there's a motion on the floor to defer 1A.
Till when? Councillor McDonnell, there was a motion on the floor to defer 1A. Yes. Until when?
Well, for a month, and until after we speak to them at our next council meeting. Or at next priority meeting, for a month.
Okay. I have one question for staff. If we defer this item for a month, is that going to have any impact on what we're doing? Mr. McIntyre?
Thanks, Madam Chair. No, presuming that council supports the other, there's a lot on the to-do list there, so let us get doing those other things. And that's why I mentioned we are meeting with them on Thursday. We'll have that discussion. We'll extend the invitation. They come to the next council meeting so we can get clarity on this. Again, we're not going the Langley route where they got out in front of the process and got the service provider on board, nor are we waiting for BC Housing. We're kind of pushing a bit, but we want to work with them. And so that's why it may not be abundantly clear what we're recommending here or in the report, but we're trying to keep things going. Staff is comfortable with deferring this part of it. We don't want to get offside. At the end of the day, we all want to work towards achieving a project there. So we don't want to get offside with that. So we're comfortable. Set aside. We'll talk to them this week. We'll get them back. We'll invite them to come to a council meeting as soon as we can.
Okay, thank you. So then on the motion to defer, are there any other speakers? Seeing none, all in favor of the motion to defer? Opposed? Carries unanimously.
Madam Chair, I'll now reactivate the first queue, and that will allow the speakers to proceed.
Okay, Councillor McDonnell. Okay, you're off. No, actually, I have Councillor Lynch.
Oh, well, actually, perhaps if the mayor is able to come to the chair. My question had to do with we're talking about being in constant contact with the minister responsible. It was a year ago. It was March 2009. The city signed the MOU, and then we're in December of that same year. We're saying what's going on. And then we finally get a response in February 2010, saying it's a top priority, which we keep hearing. And now I'm hearing, somewhat, I think, assurances from the mayor that he's been in constant contact with the ministry. Now he says the funding is going to be made available, and I'm reading back to the response from the letter. It was talking about when the economic situation improves, and that's certainly not what I've been hearing from a lot of the associations that are getting cuts and on and on. So I'm wondering if I could get some clarification. I would love to know that the memorandum of understanding is going to be signed by the provincial government imminently, and I'm just wondering what type of assurances that the mayor has been getting in that respect.
Thank you. I'm back in the chair. Thank you very much, Councillor Reamer. I'll tell you what the minister told me, and the minister has never lied to me. He said he's moved it up on the priority list, and he thinks he'll be able to get some funding this year and within a short time, and he was talking about a month or two, to allow him to proceed with those projects that are on the highest on the priority list, and ours was one of them. I'll take that at face value. I'm not going to suggest that something might not change, but the minister was very forthcoming, and he did say that this project was, he's moved it up in the priority list. It was a high priority before. He's always assured me of that. It's higher now. And I think the province has moved forward with homeless initiatives in other jurisdictions, and I think he does want to see this one go forward. But that's it. I'm giving you what he told me, and I'm taking it at face value.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is probably within the next couple of months, it's a high priority. But if my memory serves me correct, I think we're already in the top three, so we must be pretty close to number one then.
Well, I think we're number one, and I trust that the minister thinks so too, but I won't put those words in his mouth because he didn't identify it that way.
One last question. When will you be in communication with the minister again then?
I'm actually waiting. I was waiting for BC Housing to return my call this afternoon. They didn't get back to me. I'll be talking to the minister again within the month, and unless I see him again before then. I actually saw him at the prayer breakfast, Vancouver prayer breakfast the other morning, and had a short chat with him, but he didn't, we weren't able to touch on this subject. We touched on a number of others, okay, including Riverview Hospital.
Then my final request would be that you would communicate to us again once you've had another
Absolutely, I do.
With the minister. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you. I see we've gone through the speaker's queue. We're left with a motion that covers 1, B, and C, number 2, number 3, and number 4. I don't feel there was a need to, I didn't hear a need to divide those any further. So are there any debate on those? Seeing none. All in favor of 1, B, C, 2, 3, and 4. All opposed. Motion carries unanimously. There was actually one, actually I should have brought this up earlier. There was one, I had one concern, and it was related to the word, the wording of number 4. Direct staff to initiate dialogue with cities of Port Coquitlam. I know we've been on had ongoing dialogue, and I'm going to ask council's indulgence to have that word reflect continue the dialogue with Port Coquitlam and Port Moody. I don't see any objection. The motion is approved as amended. Thank you.
Item 6.6 concerns Austin Heights Neighbourhood Plan. It's Progres Report number 3. The recommendation is that council receive the Progres Report from the General Manager of Planning Development, that council provide any inputs and comments regarding the preferred draft conceptual land use plan for the neighborhood core, and authorize staff to seek public input on the preferred draft conceptual land use plan for Austin Heights neighborhood plan as outlined in the report.
Second. Move by Councillor Asmussen, second by Councillor Robinson. All in favor?
No.
Okay. Councillor Reamer.
Sorry, thank you. There were, in the minutes of our Land Use and Economic Development Standing Committee meeting dated April the 12th, there was an item in there that's actually kind of an action item and should probably be added to the list of recommendations here. So I was thinking we should just make this 6.6 actually 7.2 so that we can approve those minutes. I can highlight the discrepancy or where the action item needs to be, and then we can go ahead and approve these recommendations with the addition of one other action item. Would that be?
I think that's fine.
Okay.
Okay, we can defer until after the approval of the minutes, and with the agreement of council, this motion will move forward as already moved and seconded.
Okay.
Sorry.
The motion's been moved and seconded, so we'll move it forward, or we'll considered after we consider the minutes of the land use meeting, item 7.
Very well. Okay. No objection to that. Mr. Clerk.
Item 7 is the minutes of the Land Use and Economic Development Standing Committee meeting held Monday, April 12th. Recommendations to receive those minutes.
Second. Move by Councillor Lynch, second by Councillor Robinson. All in favor? No. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. In the minutes of the April 12th land use meeting, we had discussed, and it's indicated in here, the three options that we were going to send to the open house. Those I would like added as a recommendation to 6.6. There's no action item here in these minutes, and there probably ought to be.
I do recall a discussion, and I'm not sure how it was resolved. I don't recall the resolution of it, but there was a discussion that there was an option A and
well,
option
there was
B.
Option 1, 2, and 3,
that's
if
right.
I recall correctly.
And those the second and third options included expansions, one to the west, northwest, I guess, and one to the east, and all three were to have been submitted for public consultation, I believe.
That's right.
And staff took that as direction to do so and was going to proceed in that manner.
Okay, well, my question to staff is then, ought that not to be part of the recommendations that we pass concerning the Austin Heights neighborhood plan?
It is possible to include them if council deems it desirable, absolutely.
We're on approval of the minutes at this point,
yeah.
And I suspect that we ought to have the minutes reflect that element, and then out of that will flow a better understanding of the recommendation that we've set aside for a moment here.
So motion to amend the minutes then to include that action item or the minute.
I believe the minutes reflect the discussion that took place at the committee. What I would suggest is that it's possible to approve the minutes as they are, but that this particular aspect of them be included as a recommendation in the consideration
okay.
of the report.
All right, we'll do it that way then, that's fine.
Okay, so as the minutes now read, the committee directed staff to include the following three options in the proposed boundaries in the public open house scheduled in May 2010, and that included the area on Ridgeway and the area between Marmont and Gaitonsbury, the area of Austin between Marmont and Gaitonsbury. And so we're comfortable with that incorporated into the recommendation we're going to consider in a moment.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Just wanted to confirm my...
Councillor Lynch. Have to get your microphone going in a second. Councillor,
yeah.
I was just going to query. These are the minutes of the Land Use and Economic Development Standing Committee. They're the ones that approved, and council just receives them. So, for council to be amending them is
yeah.
a bit more unusual.
It
should
is.
Be the committee that does all this.
Yeah. Yeah, the motion it wasn't to amend. We're sort of taking the minutes as they read, and we're going to incorporate that into the action item that's been deferred.
That's correct. The minutes reflect the discussion held in the committee, but that the discussion here will be used as the source for the amendment of the item.
Motion is to approve the minutes. Doubts? Nope. All in favor?
Opposed?
Carried. Now we're going to return to 6.6, the Austin Heights Neighborhood Plan, Progress Report Number 3, and the action item associated with it. Mr. Stevlin.
If I'm reading this correctly, I believe the amendment should be on the third recommendation. Instead of us read it, it would be authorized staff to seek public input on the three options for the draft conceptual land use plans, plural, for the Austin Heights, as outlined. And I think that would capture what you're looking for.
Motion is to amend, as described by Mr. Stevlin. Second, moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Robinson on the amendment. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor of the amendment? Opposed? Amendment carries. The motion. Has the motion been moved?
The original motion was moved, yes.
Great. Got that. That would help.
Yes.
On the motion, as amended, any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. It must be raining.
we
hear the sound of pitter patter here. So,
or if there is a blackberry near an open mic. Item 7.3 concerns a proposed official community plan amendment. It's for community greenhouse gas reduction, Bill 27. Concerns bylaw number 4110. The recommendation is the council give first read in the City of Coquitlam Citywide Official Community Plan Amendment Bylaw 4110, and that in accordance with the Local Government Act, consider this bylaw in conjunction with the 2010 to 2014 Financial Plan Bylaw 4079 and the Regional Solid Waste Management Plan. That this bylaw and its related application be referred to public hearing, and that having given consideration to the requirements of Section 879 of the Local Government Act, direct staff to send copies of the bylaw 4110 to the following agencies prior to the public hearing.
Okay. Is there a motion? I'll go straight to a speaker's list. Councillor Robinson.
Okay. Actually, I have an amendment to the motion.
Okay. Well, why don't we get a motion on
so
the floor?
So that's what I'd like to wait for.
Move the motion.
Moved by Councillor McDonnell, second by Councillor Asmussen. Councillor Robinson on
thank,
a...
Thank you very much. In our committee meeting, talked about... I expressed some concern about emphasizing the cooperation of senior levels of government to really... For us to be successful in this, and I think at municipal level, we have some capacity to actually have some influence and to make some changes here. But what I noticed, page 1 of Schedule A, we talk about the need for a broader cooperation. We say it right in the bottom, that it's clear that the city's community-wide greenhouse gas reduction targets will only be reached with further action by senior levels of government, particularly in the key sectors of buildings and transportation, like tailpipe emissions, all that kind of stuff, is really good, where the big impact's going to be. I would actually like to see this bold, because I think we need to be really clear that we can do what we can do, but I think we need to make a really... I would like us to make a really strong statement that says, but if senior levels of government don't act as well, that we're not going to meet our targets. And I hate missing a target. I think it's important that we have realistic goals and that we do everything we can to achieve them. But the truth is, unless senior levels of government do their part, we're not going to make it either. And I hate to miss a goal.
That was a motion to amend.
Yes.
Amendment would be to bold in all caps or something like
something.
That.
Something. Bold. Bold would be fine.
The wording related to requiring further action by senior levels of government. Motion to amend. Is there a seconder?
I'll second
that. And seconded by Councillor McDonnell. Councillor Robinson, any further on the amendment? On the amendment. Councillor Reamer?
Actually, it's not on her amendment, but I was...
Okay. Is there any speakers on the amendment? We'll go with bold. All in favor of bold, other than our typesetter. All opposed? Seeing none, the motion carries on the motion as amended. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. I seem to recall discussion going back to our April 12th meeting again. I seem to recall that I had requested at that time that we send copies of this bylaw out to those who provided input. And I don't see that on here.
In the minutes itself, it says that those who provided feedback in the process be included in the distribution of proposed OCP amendment bylaw, and that will indeed take place. The list of bodies here are those in relation to the requirements of Section 879 and the more formal process, but absolutely the direction received about sending out to other participants has been noted and will take place.
That's great. Thank you.
So the list is developed because of statute?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Considerations of statute, and the list of other participants is much larger. And
yep, thank you. I see one other speaker dumped off the list. Seeing no other speakers, the motion as amended. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 7.4 concerns a proposed road cancellation application adjacent to 2980 Guilford Way. It's bylaw 4077. Recommendations that Council give first, second, and third readings to City of Coquitlam Highway Dedication Cancellation Bylaw 4077 and direct that this bylaw be advertised in accordance with the requirements of the Community Charter.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, second by Councillor Lynch to cancel a small road. Any discussion? All in favour? Opposed? Carried unanimously. On this item, before we get to it, Councillor Asmussen.
Thank you very much. I will be excusing myself as a perceived potential conflict. This is within the proximity of my property. Thank you.
Mr. Asmussen lives near this property, and he'll absent himself because of the perception of conflict. Thank you very much, Mr. Clerk.
This concerns the authorization for the issuance of a development permit for a 44-unit street-oriented village home development at 1299 Coast Meridian. The recommendation is that council approve the signing and sealing of this development permit and the mayor and city clerk be authorized to execute it.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor McDonnell, I think. Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Can someone get Mr. Asmussen? That the pause wasn't long enough. Mr. Clerk.
Item 7.6 concerns a preliminary report on application for a citywide official community plan amendment bylaw 4104 and zoning amendment bylaw 4105. It also relates to a 5% park dedication provision for a proposed subdivision at 1395 1403 Coast Meridian, 3400 and 3410 Highland Drive, and 3409, 3415, 3421, and 3431 Queenston Avenue. The recommendations that council give first reading to see Coquitlam citywide official community plan amendment bylaw number 4104. That in accordance with the Local Government Act, council consider this bylaw in conjunction with the 2010 to 2014 financial plan, bylaw 4079, and Metro Vancouver's waste management plans. The council give first reading to City of Coquitlam zoning amendment bylaw 4105, and that these two bylaws and the related applications be referred to public hearing. And finally, in accordance with Section 941 of the Local Government Act, that the owner of the proposed subdivision provide lands of equal 5%.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Lynch. Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Final item arising out of the minutes of that standing committee's meeting concerns the Riverview redevelopment. The recommendation is that the request by the Riverview Committee to write a letter to the province inquiring about the contents of the soon-to-be-closed Riverview and forensic libraries and promoting the benefits of institutional care for some types of mental illness be endorsed and that this matter be referred to council for further discussion.
So moved.
I'll second for discussion. Moved by Councillor Asmussen, seconded by Councillor Reamer for discussion. Does anyone want to discuss it? I have actually one concern, and that relates to the wording related to the benefits of institutional care. I'm not sure that the committee or council wants to weigh in on the medical benefits of any particular type of therapy, and I would urge us perhaps to not include that element in the letter, but I do think we can make a strong case for the continued use of that site for delivery of mental health services as we have in the past. And I see two, Councillor Robinson to begin.
Thank you. The way I understood the message from the Riverview Committee was that they wanted to be able to advocate as voice of the community to the province about the value of this this gem, this jewel that's right in the middle of our community, and encourage the province to continue looking at it as a possible place where you can actually use maybe not the facilities there, but use the land as a place where people can rehabilitate and get healthy. Whether the committee writes the letter or the mayor on behalf of council writes the letter or perhaps it's a joint letter, I think is what they're looking for. My suggestion would be that if council is comfortable that a combined letter from the chair of the Riverview Committee and the mayor write a letter advocating that Riverview continue to provide ongoing care to those who need it.
Thank you very much, and I'll that the Riverview lands.
The Riverview lands.
This yes. Riverview Hospital itself, right. The institution, is about to be closed, but the lands continue to be used for mental health deliveries indefinitely because there's a number of new buildings, for example, that are just completed. Councillor Reamer.
Well, my comments were in line with yours, Mayor Stewart, regarding the letter that says promoting the benefits of institutional care. I think probably there's another way to reword that. I have no problem with the letter going out under joint signatures. I think it would be nice to recognize the committee, being that it was their recommendation, and also have it signed by Mayor Stewart. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Secor.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. I sit on the committee, and what has happened, that I'll tell you, I, for one, are very, very concerned that the fact is they're going to be moving the last 210 patients out of Riverview Hospital, and then it'll mean that that hospital is empty, and anything can happen. And to me, I smell a rat. I really do. To me, they've been trying to develop that land for housing and other things, and I think that land is too valuable to be used for housing. I think it needs to remain as it is, and maybe with some other items to be put in there. But certainly, I'm just a little concerned that the fact is once all the people have been moved out of there, that you can almost, the government can do almost anything that they want with the land. I know that they have to come to us for rezoning and a few other things, but they don't really have to adhere to it. And that's the frightening part about it, that they can do as they see fit. So I'm really, really concerned, as the committee was concerned, with what could be the future of Riverview land. So I don't think for 1 minute that we should be relaxing in here in the council chambers, or the committee should be relaxing and saying, okay, I'll be looked after, because I'm afraid that they wouldn't like what could be happening in here. So I'm really concerned on this one. Thank you, Mayor.
Okay, I guess the recommendation is before us that we not relax, that we actually write a letter. There's been a couple of suggestions for editing it, and one of them is that it would be a joint letter signed by the mayor on behalf of council and signed by the chair of the committee. And the second one is that we would find other wording, or else remove the benefits of institutional care and perhaps talk about the site and the benefits of the site and its long-term history in serving the mentally ill. If there's a motion to amend, we can get going on that.
Second.
The amendment's been moved by Councillor Lynch, seconded by Councillor Robinson. Any discussion on it? Seeing none, all in favour of the amendments? Opposed? The amendments carry. The letter as amended would now be jointly signed and as amended as discussed. Any further discussion? All in favour? Opposed? Carried. And on behalf of Council, I want to thank the committee for their diligence and continuing to look after what truly is a jewel in Coquitlam, a jewel in the Lower Mainland, an incredible piece of property that we want to protect for public uses. Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Your Worship. Item 8 is the minutes of the Engineering, Utilities, and Environment Standing Committee meeting of Monday, March 22nd. The recommendation is to receive those minutes.
Moved by Councillor Robinson, seconded by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
First item of business arising out of that meeting concerns the King Edward Street overpass fit and finish recommended design. Recommendations that council approve the recommended design elements for the fit and finish of the King Edward Street overpass.
So moved.
Moved by Councillor Robinson, seconded by Councillor Reamer. Councillor Robinson.
I just want to take a moment to acknowledge staff on this one. I have to tell you how impressed I was with how many times went back and forth with so many different groups. It really, from where I sat on different committees, it really was a collaborative process to make all of these things fit, and then going back again and double-checking with different groups and making sure that everyone's voice came to the table. And my hat's off to those of you who made a point of making sure that we covered off all aspects. I really appreciate that.
Thank you very much. I too want to acknowledge the Millardville Residents Association, any number of groups, our staff, the staff of the contractor that's undertaking the work. This has been a very much a collaborative effort over a number of years now. Certainly the past year has been very fruitful. As we've now realigned an overpass, we've undertaken a massive piece of infrastructure that I think will serve us very well for generations to come and make us really, really connect Millardville back to the river and do so, according to this report, in a very aesthetically pleasing way, and I think a way that will satisfy a lot of our residents' concerns. So the motion on the floor, all in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 9 is the minutes of the Engineering, Utilities, and Environment Standing Committee meeting held Monday, April 12th. The recommendation is to receive those minutes.
Moved by Councillor Robinson, seconded by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 9.2 concerns Coquitlam Local Bus Transit Service Review. The recommendation is that Council direct staff to forward the report to TransLink, Coast Mountain Bus Company, the City of Port Coquitlam, and the City of Port Moody, that TransLink and Coast Mountain Bus Company initiated immediate review of the local bus routing and coverage identified in the report and implement the necessary improvements by the fall. That staff be directed to coordinate and convene a meeting with the respective committees of the cities of Port Coquitlam and Port Moody to discuss and address broader transit issues affecting services in the Northeast sector, and that staff be directed to report back on the outcome of the service review by TransLink and the Coast Mountain Bus Company and the progress of the above-noted meetings.
Thank you. I'm going to ask Councillor Asmussen, who chairs that committee, for a short, I guess, synopsis of this particular initiative.
Thank you, Mayor Stewart. This is just about trying to be proactive in the City of Coquitlam in finding ways to improve our transit system from our staff and our point of view in the region, and directing that through to TransLink Coast Mountain to see the necessary needs of our residents rather than being coming from TransLink to us. And I think this is something we want to do on an ongoing basis to find out how to better serve our people to get around. And it also links in with the item we dealt with earlier about the ways of improving greenhouse gas reductions. We give better service to our people connectively throughout our city will help. And so that's what the reason that this is brought forward. So thank you, Mayor Stewart, and I'll move the item.
Moved by Councillor Asmussen. Second by Councillor Lynch. Any discussion? A lot of discussion at committee, but none here. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 9.3 concerns the strategic transportation plan update. Proposed public advisory group members. Recommendations that council appoint the persons or groups identified in attachment A to the report. That staff be directed to engage the community associations identified in attachment B to the report in the public consultation process of the strategic transportation plan update.
Okay, the appointment of persons and groups.
Second.
Moved by Councillor Asmussen, seconded by Councillor Robinson. Councillor Reamer.
Thank you. I just had a quick question with respect to the public advisory group membership. I see that Glen Pine Seniors Association is here. Just wondering about Dogwood. There again, we've got two residents from Southwest Coquitlam and one resident from North Coquitlam, so I was wondering about that as well. And I just a quick question then about the community associations list. Have you got representation from all those associations?
I'm looking to Mr. Suzak.
Yeah, thank you, Your Worship. Regarding the community associations, the intent is to certainly keep them informed. I don't have personal information at the moment, you know, in terms of exactly who from those associations might be contacted,
okay.
But we will be sending the chair of those associations notification of all of the meetings, all of the minutes. You had a first question regarding other representation.
Right.
I think it had to do with you know, numbers from Southwest Coquitlam, Northeast Coquitlam. The advisory committee was 18. We did tailor it down to 15. Trying to. I guess fit the spirit of council's intent to come up with a more, I think, manageable group, while still retaining the legitimacy of broad representation. If there are groups out there that where it's felt that more information, for example, is needed, I think we can put them on our mailing list, just like community associations. At the moment, we haven't thought of increasing the advisory group because that was actually an issue that council grappled with, and mm-hmm. one of the reasons why we went back was to reconsider how many we have. So if there are constituents who, say, have some sort of a formal group representation, we'd like to hear about that, and we can certainly keep them informed, I think, in that way. I hope that goes somewhere to answering your question, but I haven't got details on exactly why did one particular person get on or why not another.
Well, I keeping it away from the people, it was, I was just looking, you know, you've got two representatives from Southwest Coquitlam, you've got one from North Coquitlam, and then you've got one from our seniors group here in North Coquitlam, and the other dog, and no representation from the other Dogwoods. So I was just questioning that. I understand the need to keep the numbers down because it makes it much more workable if we do keep the numbers down, but that was just a question I had.
I'm happy to take that as the direction to go and do a little bit of research. We can certainly get back to council with some further information in that regard, at least let you know how the selections were done.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Reamer. Mr. Suzak. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much. I think that, you know, we can pick many, many people from different parts of the community and always keep adding on. We have a committee of about 12 or 15 on this committee, and any committee gets over about 10 or 12 or 8, then you've got an army. And frankly, I think that, you know, I think of a lot of people that probably should be put on there also, but enough is enough. I don't think that we need a committee of 36 or 40 to get some information in this community. And that's all I'm going to say. I think that that committee is about 12 right now, which is plenty big enough. And I don't think we need any add-ons. Thank you.
Yep. Well, we certainly aren't contemplating a committee of 30. Seeing no other speakers, the motion is to establish the strategic transportation plan public advisory group. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 9.4 concerns a local area service at Tide Place. The recognition is council directs staff to proceed with a local area service on Tide Place with curb and gutter and notify the property owners of this work.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Robinson. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 10 concerns the minutes of the Recreation, Sports, and Culture Standing Committee meeting held Monday, March 22nd. The recommendations that these minutes be received.
Moved by Councillor Asmussen, seconded by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
First item arising out of these minutes concerns the Canada Geese management in Como Lake Park. The recommendations of council approve the proactive management of the Canada Geese population in Como Lake Park, which includes the following initiatives: adding legs to reduce the number of goose eggs successfully hatched, posting signage and focusing on the communicating to park users the need to restrict the feeding of ducks and geese.
Goose management. Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor McDonnell. Councillor Sikora.
Thank you very much. To the Parks and Recreation Director, who manages this? Is it our staff, or are we hiring somebody special to look after this?
If approved, we will be contracting with an outside qualified provider.
Could not our staff be qualified providers just to make sure that those eggs don't hatch?
Through the chair, there are regulatory requirements that need to be met to do this work, and our staff are not currently qualified to do this work.
Okay, thank you.
Now, these are migratory birds, so the regulations are federal regulations?
That's correct.
Thank you very much. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I've also been doing a little bit of research and addling. I mean, it sounds cruel, and perhaps, it is. But I also appreciate that, you know, we do have a goose problem. And when there's geese, there's goose poop. And we don't like that in our parks. What I also understand that we want to post signage and focusing on communicating, and I'm wondering if there's more that we could do to communicate to folks to just not feed the birds. We do so much to get people to not feed the bears, but I'm wondering if, you know, if there's anything else we can do about not feeding the birds besides just signage. If there's more of an education program, we have the media here. I'm hoping that they'll get on board so that we don't have to do it. I also have another question that has to do with the habitat that's there. And there was a suggestion that what we may want to do is plant higher grasses in around the shoreline. And I'm wanting to know if that might be something that we might look at just so that they don't make themselves at home there. If we can make it a bit more uncomfortable for them, maybe they'll go somewhere else.
All right. Your Worship, so in response to other efforts we could make in terms of communication, the signage is one of the primary means, but we'll also be utilizing some summer students to also do some one-on-one communication with park users. That's part of the plan. And with respect to changing vegetation in the park, that is, there's many best management practices. There's other more aggressive means that we could use to manage the geese, but this is really our first year about with respect to doing this work, and it's more sort of getting a baseline and doing some of the minimum work and potentially looking at other options in the future, but that could be effective.
Great, thank you.
And I had a similar question. Have in the past, have we done things that inadvertently encouraged? I'm speaking 5 years ago, I remember a good amount of work that was done to reclaim part of the park that allowed it to be used more for wildlife. Is that part of the challenge that we're facing now, is that there are some nice areas for geese to now live?
I'm not familiar with all the work that was done in the past, but I know there was some recent or somewhat recent habitat enhancement work in terms of planting native trees and shrubs, and that would actually discourage the geese because they like the open lawn areas that we mow on a somewhat regular basis. That's the habitat that they're using in the park. So.
Okay, seeing no other speakers, on behalf of council, I would urge everybody that knows people that feed the geese, this is a serious issue. When we feed wild animals, and bears or geese, bad things happen. And in this case, we have to step in now to try to manage a challenge that we've created as humans. And so the motion before us is the Canada Geese Management in Como Lake Park. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 11 is the minutes of the Recreation, Sports, and Culture Standing Committee meeting of Monday, April 12th. Recommendations to receive those minutes.
Second. Moved by Councillor McDonnell, second by Councillor Robinson. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
The item of business arising out of those minutes concerns the Prairie Sport and Leisure Complex, the spectator seating guard height and lounge and dining area upgrade. Recommendations that council direct staff to proceed with spectator guard option C, which involves metal supports and glass panel inserts, and two, that council direct staff to convert the smaller multi-purpose room on the second floor of the Prairie Complex to a lounge and dining area.
Second. Moved by Councillor Lynch, second by Councillor Reamer. Councillor McDonnell.
This is through to Ms. McKay. For the lounge up there in the arena, this lounge is going to be specifically for adults and for people to go and enjoy an alcoholic beverage. Will there be restrictions as to age restrictions going in there?
Ms. McKay.
Yes, Your Worship. This is being designed as an adult-oriented area, and there will be signage and efforts to limit youth in this area, although adults that wish to have family members come in with them, that will be permitted.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Seeing no other questions. The motion is the adjustments of the guard height and the lounge and dining areas at the Sports Center. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 12 is the minutes of the Strategic Priorities Administration Protective Services Standing Committee meeting of Monday, March 22nd. Recommendations that these minutes be received.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Oh, Councillor Support. There are the minutes. Opposed to the adoption of the minutes. Okay. Councillor Segura is opposed. The motion carries. Mr. Clerk.
The item 12.3 concerns a smoking ban for city parks. The recommendation is that council give first, second, and third readings to city smoking control bylaw, amending bylaw 4108-2010.
Second. Moved by Councillor Asmussen, seconded by Councillor Reamer. Councillor Sikora.
Yeah, Mayor, that's what I'm opposed to is you know, we can, I understand that, you know, smoking is a very, very bad habit. I used to have that habit till 1972 myself, and it's not healthy. There's many things that are, you know, you can talk all day about it. That the fact is, it's no good for you. But the fact is, you know what? We're passing bylaws just for the sake of passing bylaws. And I don't know how good that is. We have no enforcement on it. Because during the week, at 8 o'clock in the evening, after that, we don't have no bylaws. Till 8 o'clock in the morning or so, we don't have no bylaw officers, you know, to enforce this kind of thing. Certainly not going to send the fire department there to enforce it. Neither are you going to send the policeman to enforce it, because the fact is, you know, the police have more important things to do than that. But, you know, to just put bylaws in for the sake of saying, hooray, we did it. I think it's a false expectation up there to the general public. And I think we ought to pass bylaws that cannot be enforced or non-enforceable. Thank you very much. I'm going to be voting against this one, Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I'm pleased that it's a beginning. However, I mentioned in our meeting that this is really a fire hazard bylaw. It's really not a whole lot of reference to exposure to secondhand smoke. So it's a smoking ban for city parks that protects our parks from garbage, and it protects our forests from risk of forest fire. And yes, I suppose it promotes healthy lifestyle, but it doesn't really speak to the things that I'm concerned about, which are exposure to secondhand smoke. So some people asked me over the last few days if I was going to be supporting this because it didn't go far enough. But I thought, well, how can I not support it? Because I think it's a step in the right direction. So I will be supporting it, but I just don't think it goes far enough, and I look forward to additional dialogue that will speak to the health of our citizens, and that we're a committed council that is concerned about the exposure, particularly of children, to secondhand smoke. So I look forward to future debate.
Thank you. Councillor McDonnell.
Thank you. Well, we all know the effects of smoke, and we know how bad it is for you. But we all own, in Coquitlam, we all own our parks, and we have to look out for our parks. And then the long-term forecast is for drier and hotter weather. We have to mitigate any opportunity for a fire to start in our parks, and we've already had some close calls at Monday Park and other parks around the city. So I fully support this, and I'm hoping it'll pass.
Thank you. I'm going to support it as well for many of the same reasons. Mundy Park is another jewel, and I remember when I used to work at the Parks Department, we ended up one day finding a fire that had been started by a carelessly dropped cigarette on the grassy areas outside Spaney Pool, and a bunch of employees of the city had to try to put it out before the fire department got there because it was going to hit the bushes. There are some real risks associated with urban forests like Mundy Park. When they dry out, they become tinder dry, and there are so many interface opportunities for fires to leap from other buildings, leap to other buildings that butt up against the park as well. So those kinds of risks are enormous. We also spent millions of dollars putting in artificial turf on a number of our playing fields in Coquitlam, and a carelessly dropped cigarette could cause some damage there as well. It's not something that we want to place at risk. Our parks belong to everybody, and so I fully support the idea of this. As far as bylaw enforcement goes, for almost all the hours that a park is open, we have bylaw enforcement officers. In fact, in the case of Town Center Park, we have staff there for the hours that it's open as well. So there are challenges associated with enforcing it, certainly, but we will rise to those challenges. We will make sure that we protect our parks. Seeing no other speakers, all in favor? Opposed. Councillor Secor is opposed. All in, motion carries.
Item 12.5 concerns the Evergreen ALRT project update. The recommendation is that Council forward a letter and copy of the Evergreen Line Rapid Transit Project Lincoln Avenue Northern Avenue business case to the Premier and the Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure, requesting the following: that pursuant to the throne speech, the province proceed with the construction of the Evergreen Line, identify sustainable long-term funding for TransLink without an additional property tax burden, and instructs TransLink to develop a supplemental budget for 2011, which includes necessary capital and operating funds for the Evergreen Line, addressing the current funding gap. Two, that the province include construction of a city center station in the vicinity of Lincoln Avenue and Northern Avenue as part of the base project scope. And three, the province include in the project evaluation and proponent selection criteria a provision which provides higher weighting to a guideway which is the most visually unobtrusive.
Thank you very much. In keeping with Councillor Lynch's earlier request, I will actually let Council know again. I had a conversation with the Premier last week about the Evergreen Line and about funding and about the TransLink challenges the Mayor's Council is currently wrestling with. The Premier reiterated that our own position is that we know we're working with the engineers. The line is being engineered now. It's going to be built. There should be a shovel in the ground within a year, and I'm fully committed that that will happen, and I fully expect that that will happen. We're still left, though, with those challenges associated with the ongoing and the ongoing operational funding of TransLink. TransLink needs to get millions of dollars in additional operational funding to allow it to properly run a system that will meet the needs of a community that we want to continue to be the most livable region in the world, and you can't do that without a proper transit system. I will support the recommendation. Councillor Secora.
Yeah, thank you very much. On this Evergreen Line, I also hear some rumors that the provincial government is going to, this comes from the GVD, that the provincial government is going to legislate this LRT to Coquitlam and then put it on property taxes. And matter of fact, one guy said, well, your mayor knows that. Now, you know, I don't know what the discussion was at the GVD or ever anything, but the fact is that there was discussion that this is what's going to happen, that the Premier and his party are going to legislate Evergreen Line to Coquitlam and put on property tax, and I'm really, really concerned about that.
Well, there's no question. There's all kinds of rumors out there. The GVRD actually isn't responsible for transportation. It's the Mayor's Council on Regional Transportation at TransLink. I've heard those rumors. I've heard lots of other rumors. I've heard the mayor next door say it will never get built. But I think you have to take the once again, we have to work with the provincial government. We have to work with TransLink to identify the appropriate funding sources to make sure that this line gets built and that TransLink continues to operate in a sustainable way, a world-class transportation system. Councillor McConnell.
Well, in keeping with the spirit that Councillor Robinson started earlier this evening, I think we should bold type this part here about construction of a city center station. I think that's the most important one that we could possibly have in Coquitlam. So I hope we add a lot of weight to that one.
I'll take that as instruction to council or to staff that we, when we do write the letter, it will have bold face on city center station. Any other discussions? Seeing none, we're writing a letter. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 12.6 concerns the 2011 financial plan schedule. The recommendation is that Council approve the attached 2011 financial plan schedule, including the addition of 5 meetings of the Strategic Priorities Administration and Protective Services Standing Committees on May 10th, November 1st, 8th, 9th, and 27th, 2010.
Move recommendation.
Moved by Councillor McDonnell, second by Councillor Reamer. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. I'm actually wondering if we can make an amendment to the May 10th date. We're going to have a by-election on May 15th, and I'm just wanting to know if it would make sense to have our full complement available for all of the budget process rather than that person missing that first meeting, if that would be at all possible.
We will certainly look at this. What I would suggest is that you pass this resolution, but we'll take that under advisement and look for another date. Sometimes there are difficulties in terms of finding dates, but anyway, I think we do need the full suite of meetings to have all the discussions we need. So that's what my recommendation to pass this, and I'll look for another date.
That would be great. Thank you.
If I could ask any of the candidates who are present today to keep your schedule free for the end of May. No other speakers? This is to add some committee meetings. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously.
Item 13 is a staff report from the General Manager of Leisure and Park Services that concerns beautification initiatives. The recommendations that Council approve the beautification initiatives outlined in the report of the General Manager, specifically the installation of a fountain at Lafarge Lake, noting that sponsorship funding has been obtained to cover the cost of the fountain, the installation of decorative landscape lighting at Lafarge Lake, the provision of electrical infrastructure to support the lighting fountain and adjacent special event area, and the installation of a living sculpture in the plaza of the Poirier Civic Precinct on the west side of the library. Two, the Council approved the allocation of funds in the amount of $125,000 from the 2010 Community Capital Fund. The Council recognized the contribution of $50,000 from Westbuild Holdings towards the cost of the fountain and the contribution of $5,000 from Polygon Homes towards the cost of the decorative landscape lighting at Lafarge Lake, including an opening ceremony or public unveiling. And the Council approved the annual operating costs associated with these initiatives.
Second. Moved by Councillor McDonnell, second by Councillor Lynch. Councillor Sikora.
Say a few things about a couple of developers that have been in this city for many years. I remember years ago when certainly Wessel Plateau was nothing but bare ground, and the fact is it was sold by the provincial government and Westbuilt bought it. And the fact is they came to this community, and the first thing I heard from them that they said, look, we're developers, so we're going to service the land, and we're going to sell the land to some developers that will build houses, and in fact, you know, we just want to be somebody who just develops in the city, takes the money, and disappears. We want to be part of the community. And they became part of the community. Matter of fact, Westbuilt came to me years ago and said, we'd like to pay $250 for every unit or every lot we service. And then certainly the house builders came aboard because they got 20-odd builders in the, to a meeting, and they all came aboard, also paying $250 per house that they built. Then, at a later date, they said, we like Coquitlam, we like what we're doing, and it's been good to us, we're going to pay $450 per unit. And all the developers and builders agreed. So they're just not somebody that just comes to your city, develops, and runs. They also donated $2 million to Evergreen Cultural Center. They have supported ad and export people to a tune of, I believe it's $20,000, $25,000 for 5 years. So they worked with Adenex and many other things that they've done in this city that really you say to yourself, there's a developer that's really loyal to this city. And really, and not only that, as you know, right here just a couple of years ago when the city needed some roads to be built or servicing to be put in, and we didn't have the money, Westbuilt came aboard and did it for us. And they lived with it. The fact is, until we can pay it back through the DCCs. Now, these are the kind of people that we have in our community, and we should be proud of them. Because I think, and Polygon came aboard, of course, also. That works quite well with Westbuilt, and the Westbuilt service the land, and Polygon buys land and develops it. All the Morning Star is certainly a offshoot of Polygon. So these people have been very, very good. And, you know, Michael Ledane from Westbuilt, I remember when the building that he just built down the street was on fire, and he was at the Orpheum Theater to a show. He was in a tux, and he comes in a tux, and he said to the people while the units were burning, he says, we'll look after you folks. We're not going to let you down. It was already built and people were living in there. And he did. These are the people we must remember and honor in this community. Because they're not people that just develop and run or get a dirty name, or, well, you're a developer, and you take the money from the city and run. They don't. They're part of this community, I really, really respect the I know everybody calls Mr. Kawashawi Mr. K is his name, and I know that him and Randy Zine and Shirley Tedders is here from West Belt that has been with them for many years. And these are things that they do to our community, and I'm delighted to present this check from Burke Mountain Limited Partnership for $50,000. Towards the certainly the fountain in the lake, and I'd hope that we probably would be naming that fountain in the lake after Westbelt or whoever they wish it should be named after, because I think these people have been very, very good to this city and been very kind, and I know that there'll be other things that'll come aboard that the city may be chasing. So I think we should be proud of these people in our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Sikora. I don't think we'll be able to rename the lake. It was already named after a different company. But I agree that we ought to find a way to formalize better relationships and better approaches so that we can get our the corporate entities that do business in our community to allow them to participate in a more complete way in our city. And I know that I'm really excited about the possibility that we will continue to see companies moving forward, wanting to make contributions to our city. I actually want to make an adjustment if I could, and I won't move an amendment, but perhaps someone else might want to. In recommendation number two, approving the allocation of funds in the amount of, I'd like to add the word up to, because I want us to continue to look at seeing if there are additional sponsors that we may be able to find for elements of this installation, and up to would remind us that perhaps we can continue.
I'll move
that. Moved by Councillor Robinson, seconded by Councillor Lynch. The amendment, all in favor, opposed, carried unanimously. On the motion as amended, any further discussion? All in favor, opposed, carried unanimously.
Item 14 concerns the Metro Vancouver Board in brief. Our usual Metro Vancouver Board representative is not here this evening, but the recommendation is that Council receive the information from the Metro Vancouver Board in brief.
Moved by Councillor Asmussen, seconded by Councillor McDonnell. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 15 is notice of motions, the smoking bylaw. Recommendations that Council give consideration to the following notice of motion presented by Councillor Robinson and seconded by Councillor Lynch at the January 18th, 2010 regular Council meeting. There's a series of whereas clauses followed by the therefore be it resolved that the City of Coquitlam develop a ban on smoking on public patios and spaces where minors under 16 years of age might be present, and that the City of Coquitlam invites municipalities in Metro Vancouver that have yet to develop smoking bans to consider such a ban, and finally that the City of Coquitlam asks the province to consider a ban on smoking in all public spaces. Under our procedure bylaw, the mover is granted preference to speak and introduce the notice of motion.
Moving to Councillor Robinson, who moved the motion.
I understand there's another item on the agenda that actually, depending on the outcome of that item, may actually impact this item, so I'd like to defer this until that other item is dealt with.
Defer to later in the meeting?
Later in the meeting until reconsideration of a notice of motion.
Consideration of another notice of motion.
The motion is to defer until later in the meeting. Seconded by Councillor Lynch. All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Thank you. We had one a series of items under other business. The first one being an onward transmittal item. This is item 16, for which copies were provided at the back of the room, and it concerns an appointment to the Coquitlam Public Library Board, and the recommendation is that Eunice Hooper be appointed to the Coquitlam Public Library Board.
Moved by Councillor Asmussen, second by Councillor Lynch. Discussion. All in favor? Opposed? Carried. I'd like to congratulate and thank Eunice Hooper for the contribution she's going to be making to the Coquitlam Public Library Board.
Second item is that I've been asked to make an announcement by Council to the effect that staff had been directed to prepare a letter to the province under the mayor's signature requesting that it establish provincial standards to regulate combat sporting events such as boxing, wrestling, kickboxing, mixed martial arts, and like events. And I'm doing that at the request of council. That's it.
Moved by Councillor Reamer, seconded by Councillor Lynch, that we write a letter. Any discussion? All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. Carried unanimously.
And that is the last of items that the clerk's office has.
Okay, there was going to be a notice of motion from Councillor, and we'll go Councillor Sikora.
Yes, I have two notice of motions. The first notice of motion is that the format for the forthcoming town hall meeting scheduled to take place on the 5th of June be revised from what was guided the previous events of like a public hearing, that the meeting not proceed according to the existing public hearing type of format, that all members of council are permitted to actively engage with the members of the public in response to the questions, issues being raised. That each member of council be provided a microphone at each spot for their discussion, for to be able to answer some questions. And it's signed by myself and Councillor McDonnell. My second notice of motion is for the good of our residents and voters of our city of Coquitlam to have the right to the democratic process, that we allot a space in the city hall in the lobby on the second floor for our residents to be able to register their opposition and sign a petition against the HST. This space will be manned by a volunteer supplied by them, and the space will have a sign and the hours of operations. That's moved by myself, and I believe Selena Robinson was seconding it. No, that is, it's coming to you typed form, okay? Thank you, and I so move.
I'm a bit curious as to the legality of the second one, and I wonder if staff could advise me as the procedure of requesting that staff examine the, whether the Election Act actually permits the local government to get involved in a referendum or initiative process.
I think
I'll ask Mr. Clerk.
Thank you, Your Worship. I must admit I'm uncertain at this moment, but I would certainly look into it and provide a response to all of council as soon as possible after this meeting, certainly prior to the return of the notice of motion at the subsequent council meeting in which it will appear.
That would be helpful. No point passing.
I was going to suggest the same thing.
Okay. Yeah, that would help. No point passing a motion that's illegal.
I think.
Okay. So those two notices of motion will be considered at the next notices of motion will be considered at the next meeting. Councillor McDonnell?
Thank you.
You haven't pushed your button.
I have a notice of motion regarding the upcoming by-election, which hopefully we can deal with tonight. That council seek community input through the undertaking of a non-binding public opinion process to be conducted in the polling stations established as a part of general voting day on May 15, 2010. That this process be conducted separately from the formal by-election proceeding through the use of paper ballots, a distinct collection system, and a separate reporting out process. That the questions to be put before the public relate to the following two topics. A, potential modifications to the current status of off-leash hours in Monday Park. And B, potential restrictions on smoking on public patios and other spaces where minors under the age of 16 years are permitted to be present. And that staff be authorized to develop final wording of the proposed questions following upon consultation with individual members of council, which will occur on April the 20th, 2010.
Okay. I understand as well that there was consideration to passing a 60% motion to waive the 2 weeks notice provision. And would you, are you moving a
yes.
A motion to waive?
Second.
Moved by Councillor McDonnell, seconded by Councillor Asmundson to waive the 2 weeks or the notice of motion procedures. All in favor? Opposed? That carries unanimously. So we'll be considering that motion now as a council motion.
I'll put it on for the benefit of the public, I'll put it up on the document.
Thank you, Dan. I thank Councillor McDonnell for preparing this ahead of time and so that we can put it up on the screen, make sure we know what we're potentially debating here. Anything further, Councillor McDonnell?
Yes. In our last by-election, I think, believe in 2007, we had approximately a 5% voter turnout. We need to engage our voters in a better way. These two issues have a lot of voter interest, and all of council has received interest from parties on both sides of these issues, urging us to take action. Well, this is an opportunity for people to give direction to council on what actions they should be. I'm hopeful that this will encourage people to become more involved in this by-election and make their voices heard in addition to voting for their candidate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Councillor Robinson.
Thank you. Thank you. The idea of having a greater voter turnout to me is very, very appealing. Using some hot button issues, I think, is a great and creative way, and I appreciate Councillor McDonnell bringing this idea forward. I think there's a couple things we need to pay particular attention to. One, this isn't binding. The outcome is not binding. We don't have enough time to actually make this a referendum, so it's just a way for us to poll and get some more input. But I think we also need to recognize that, is this really representative? I mean, there's always the argument of, well, it's democracy, but, you know, that doesn't necessarily make it right. I have to tell you, I'm a little bit anxious for all those pro-smoking folks making sure that all those folks come out and the other side might not. So I would certainly, if this does pass, I would certainly hope that we can make sure that people see this as an opportunity to get their voices heard. I do have one concern is that sort of what do we do with this information? So we get this information, and I hope, my expectation is that, it's actually not my hope, it's actually my expectation is that these then appear on a council agenda for us to debate and to take some action on, and that we use that information to help inform us so that we are really doing our jobs and speaking on behalf of the residents and making sound policy decisions. So, for example, if we move forward with this, I'm not interested in hearing about enforcement issues, bylaw enforcement concerns, because I think that we can't bring this forward for input and then say, well, we can't enforce it, it's unenforceable. So I think if we move forward, then it means that we're going to take some action or not take some action, but that if we do take action, that we can't use those arguments that that we've heard before. So I look forward to hearing more from the public on it, making this certainly a public debate and not so much a council debate. And I look forward to the council debate. I'm hoping... Would we do this before our break? I'm just wanting to get a sense of time. I know this is a lot to spring on you, but is this the kind of thing that we get the results, we would be able to have these debates before we break in August? Is that realistic?
As noted in the motion there will be a separate reporting out process. As there's two questions, I can't speak for the business areas that are responsible for developing those policies around those two areas, but I don't think it's impossible, but I would defer to the city manager if...
We will certainly do our very best to report out in a timely manner.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Sikora.
Yeah, thank you very much. The one thing I thought about the fact is voter turnout is low, and there's no two ways about that. But I thought that, you know, mind you, this is impossible. It can't be done, but it's illegal. Because if you put that HST on a ballot, you know, not us, but have somebody in there in a polling station, each polling station, where you can oppose the HST, you'd have a 90% turnout. So that's one way of getting the people to the polls. But however, that kind of petition is not allowed in the polling station. So We are going to do our second best. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think this is, I want to congratulate Councillor McDonnell. This is a bit of a breakthrough, I think, in the way in which we approach voter engagement, citizen engagement. We have, as a council, worked hard to try to engage the public more. We have people watching us tonight on the internet because we stream live to the internet. We stream our committee meetings live to the internet, as well as archived. These are methods that we can use. There's dialogue that we can have using the internet, but also using a various number of other approaches. But engaging the public means making them feel empowered to make choices and to help us make the choices that they elect us to do. This won't be binding, and I accept that because there will be some complexities associated with the questions and how do you choose the right question and those sorts of things. But it, I think it can help guide us. I think council can be better informed and council can be better, have better tools to, in order to be able to make the decisions that the public entrusts us with. And I look forward to the results of this. I'm actually hoping that one or both of the questions have the possibility of an open-ended answer, a suggestion box, if you will, about other initiatives that might come out of these sorts of issues. Because I think the public has a lot to say. The public, many of the people and members of the public want to be heard and they want to feel engaged in the kinds of debates, the kinds of questions that we have to wrestle with here around the council table. So again, I congratulate and thank Councillor McDonnell and all of council for moving forward with what I think is a pretty neat initiative. Councillor Lynch.
And I agree this is a good initiative. I think any time we get an opportunity to hear from the public, as wide a range of public as we can, is a great idea. I just wanted to ask staff that when we're going through, or when they're going through all the work required to set this up, you can investigate a little further. Perhaps if this appears to be quite successful, we can consider this for the next fall election and how many, and I don't know how many questions would be appropriate or what the parameters would be. We discussed briefly and another time about, you know, the difference between a referendum and having a binding versus non-binding question. So perhaps at the same time, if you could bring those answers back and do all the work at once instead of me requesting it later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. The clerk's office will follow through on that.
Perfect. Thank you. Seeing no other speakers. Motion is some referendum questions. Trying to make lemonade out of the challenge of having a by-election. Let's try to put it to some good use. The motion before us, all in favor? Opposed? The motion carries unanimously.
There are no further formal items on
There is one.
Oh, sorry.
There was a motion from Councillor Robinson that was deferred. I assume that Councillor Robinson will now stand the motion down.
That's correct. I will defer it pending the outcome of the by-elect, the information that we get, and hopefully it'll enrich our discussion and we'll be able to make a good decision.
If I could ask for a motion of formal deferral, because now that it's been moved and seconded, it is owned by council.
It is owned by council. So the motion is to defer. Is there a seconder? We would defer it until after the by-election and after the staff report comes back related to the smoking side of the two questions.
Smoking gun.
All in favor? Opposed? The motion is deferred. Mr. Kirk.
The sole item remains to move adjournment.
Adjournment's been moved. I want to acknowledge National Volunteer Week and thank all of the members of the public who tuned in today, as well as National Victims of Crime Awareness Week. Motion is to adjourn. All in favor? Opposed? Carried unanimously. As is traditional in our council.